Wow.
Jim Messina here for VintageDrumsTalk.com. I'm at the 27th Vintage and Customs Chicago Drum Show. I'm glad to be here. We're going to be shooting down on the floor behind me. All the action's going on. The great collectors are here. Mike Corrado, Mark Cooper, all those guys are here. Bunny Carlos, we're going to check them all out right now. Come on along. Let's go see the best, biggest show on earth. We went down the aisle a little ways, and here's Joe Luoma. Every year, Joe, how you doing, my friend?
Doing good, Jim.
So good to see you. Look at this,
all right,
guys.
All right.
Look at this stuff. Do you believe it?
The salad bar again.
This is fantastic, man. If you guys could see these in person, unbelievable.
Anyway,
Joe, what do you got to show us?
So, always great to be at the show. We got new lighting this year. It's everything super bright, so we can see everything really well, which is great.
Very nice.
Just dropped out a few drums out here. A couple of Leedy drums. Gorgeous finishes. Black Onyx.
Okay.
And here's a Red Onyx. This is a Reliance. These are kind of unusual drums. The Red Onyx.
And didn't they make a Green Onyx?
They made a Green Onyx.
Okay.
I know Mike Corrado has a Green Onyx. So you put the green and the red together, you got Christmas.
Yeah.
But anyway, Ludwig had the same color, but theirs was called Hotsy Totsy. But the same material.
All right.
Next to it, we have, this is a real weird one. This is an old Ludwig & Ludwig.
I gotta say, I have never, ever seen this finish. In a catalog?
I don't think it was in the catalog. And
was it?
I don't think so.
I call it
cinnamon swirl. It's like a marble.
Yes.
Only marble was like a, it was green.
Joe, this is really a highlight. What's the story behind
this? It's probably a one of a kind.
Where'd you get it?
I can't remember.
How long have you had it? How long have you had it?
Same answer.
Well, we're all getting old, you know.
It's been sitting around for a long. When I got it, it was no big deal. It was back in the early days in the 90s. I was the guy who collected ugly finished drums.
Now, you know, I notice you have contemporary heads on these. How do they fit?
Fine.
You're not having a problem?
No. They fit. Ludwig heads fit. Any hit will fit a Ludwig drum, yeah.
Put a year on that.
Yeah. I don't know, 28, maybe 30, yeah. 28 to 30. Yeah, something somewhere
very
in there.
Very nice.
So I call it cinnamon swirl, but I think it's a one of.
And, you're blowing me away with that. I have never, ever seen that. That is cool.
Yeah, that is. That's a fun drum.
Here's the usual with the Gladstone.
I don't know if I had this before. I brought this to offer to somebody. I have a number of these. A Billy Gladstone. This is kind of a weird one because it originally had a really big badge. That isn't the original badge or the original owner. The original owner had to be somebody because Billy didn't see those little pins to hold the badge
in?
Yes, I see those.
Yeah.
They had a big plaque, like probably to the world's most famous drummer. La-da-da. It was originally covered. Billy made very few drums that were covered. This one was covered. Somebody peeled it and put a different nameplate on it.
Wow.
And now it's a shallow drum. You know, Buddy Rich played a shallow drum, didn't he?
Is that right?
Yeah. I wonder where his Billy Gladstone is. Who knows? It could be his. But it had to be somebody pretty big who used to cover drum.
That's pretty cool.
And with that badge. It's even got the...
Yep, there it is. The triple tuning system. Now, we've looked at these in past years. It's a very innovative
Billy
tuning
Gladstone
system.
Billy Gladstone key has the numbers on one side, 1, 2, and 3, and Billy Gladstone on the other side, top, bottom, or both, 1, 2, or 3, the three-way tuning. You don't want to lose that key.
No. Now!
And then this guy over here, Slingerland Black Beauty, really nice one, huh?
Guys, we've talked about this drum before. What was it, three or four years ago, you surprised me with, he brought this here when I found number 13 or 14, I forget, but, and he has this one. And look at the shape this drum is in. It's primo, and it's not his best. You have another one, don't you?
Yeah, I have another one. So I don't need two, so I'm offering this one up.
This one's for sale, you
for
guys!
Sale. Act now, act before midnight. Operators are standing by.
Now let me ask you, this whole row, are they all for sale?
Give me your wallet, let me see your wallet.
All these, all these drums for sale today?
Hey, I don't know, these could be, yeah.
I mean, cinnamon swirl.
Who knows?
That's hard to let go of. I don't know, boy.
I don't know.
What will happen?
That would be hard to let go of.
You never know what's going to happen here at the show.
And yeah, I think you've seen these before. These are just a couple of 60s jazz fests up here. Very rare, though. Mod orange with the purple, and then psychedelic red with the green.
Now, guys, if you could see these up close like I am, it follows Joe's motto, as I say every year, excellent to mint. That's his credo. And these drums were just back in 1970, what?
67.
67 on that one?
Yeah, probably same on that too.
They're just beautiful. They're just gorgeous. I mean, they're when he says mint, these are excellent to mint. They're beautiful. Wow. And behind us.
Okay.
Let's step out here and get a look at the rest of this collection.
Okay, this is the rest. This is the 67 20 12 14 that goes with that snare drum. Call it the psychedelic Ringo set. And here's the new invention I just came up with a couple days ago.
Look at that.
I like to play two heads on a bass drum. But sometimes I like to get in to muffle the head, depending on the room, and sometimes they want to put a mic inside the bass drum or even in the hole on the outside. So I have the option.
Come on!
Take that off.
Come on!
Dampening material. How do you keep your whites white, huh? Dampen it how I want. If they want to put a microphone, we can put the microphone in there. The cable will go, that'll pop out, the grommet, the cable goes in through there, and then it buttons back up.
Amazing. Is this a marketed product?
This is a prototype. I just finished this last week, and it's patent pending now. And so you can choose either on or off with a hole, or you can access your internal muffling. You can access an internal mic, or you can put a mic on the outside, and the mic cord goes in. And, if you have to play Brown Eyed Girl twice a night, you can probably keep a little flask in there and, help you make it through the night.
Now, this just goes to show you.
Keep your weed in there. Come on now.
This just goes to show you that Joe, on top of being a primo top collector, he's also very, very innovative, as you can see with that product right there. But I want to show you guys something. How many of you guys are using a set of these? I use them all the time.
I do too.
Guess who put this idea
into... I get a deal on them.
Joe has been very quiet about this with me. And this is Joe's invention right here. This is his product.
I'm the manufacturer too, so.
Okay.
As of a couple years ago, I sold it. They're made in St. Paul, Minneapolis area. And they're still made there. Eight employees. All eight employees are still on board. Nothing has changed.
Yep.
So,
and they're called
Minnesota
hot rods.
Product.
They work great in quiet situations. I've been using them for a year, and Joe's the one who put these out. Fantastic. Joe
Nawalma.
Yeah,
they've been fun. All right.
Hey, you guys. Joe wants to show you a couple of more inventions. This guy's a genius.
Don't go there. But remember, Columbo would always say, Just one more thing.
Yeah, I don't know what this year's song is. But
we forgot. I guess we forgot about this. My 67, here's what I always use on an old vintage kit to get the tom up in the air. I put a rod into the tom holder, and I use two Ludwig nuggets. These are off a double tom holder. Put them together and then put an L-arm. Or you could even put a tongue in there if you have a diamond plate. And you can run this as high as you want. And sometimes I even put a splash symbol on top of this. So one post will hold three things. Notice the cowbell holder. On this one, there's a Rogers.
That's what I recognize.
There's the Rogers L-arm bracket. And here's a L-arm from a Ludwig.
These are kind of hard to find.
Yeah, but it works good. And then I can run the cowbell. I've never played a set without a cowbell. Yeah. And So anyway, this has worked many, many, many years. I've used this. I've told a lot of drummers about it, and it works great to get the drums up. And
now look at this.
We forgot about this. I used the blow drum. Actually, it's on two recordings, one Nashville band and one Minneapolis band. And since my name is J-O-E, we call it the B-L-O-E drum. And I know other people have probably used this. Back in the 70s, I used to do this, but I actually play it live now. And it goes like this. You want to hold that?
My day has been made, you guys. I finally found Carl Waldman. I thought he was hiding somewhere else, and there he is right there. Look at that. He's one of my favorite drummers, I'll tell you, especially with brushes. He's got a brush technique that, man, he showed me some things, and I love it. Good to see you again, Carl. I'm so glad you could make it to the show this year.
I'm glad I had a chance to talk to you.
He just sit there hiding. I walked right by him. Thanks, man. He's sick of me. Thanks a lot, Carl. I'll see you later. Fellow collectors, Jim Messina here representing the vintage aspect of the Chicago Vintage and Custom Drum Show, the 27th year, and guess who? Larry Matthews. How you doing,
hey,
my friend?
Everybody. How you doing, bud?
As usual,
good to see you.
And he's brought some new things. Last year we saw the trilogy and a lot of Mark Cooper stuff that he bought.
Yes. Yep.
But he's got a couple of new things here, because Larry is a top primo guy as far as collecting. Why don't you show us what you got new here? Now I see the trilogy again.
We got the trilogy with the original.
If you didn't see this last year, guys, explain that trilogy again.
All the Adrian Kirschner redone stuff, beautiful stuff, a la Mark Cooper.
Look at this. This is Mark Cooper's Slingerland Black Beauty that Adrian made. This is beautiful, but I can't believe it. Larry bought the whole trilogy. How cool.
Old horse trainers we are.
By the way, did you know Larry loves to hang out on eBay? How much time do you put in on eBay?
Oh, my goodness.
You're an addict.
In the evening when I get
You're an
home,
addict.
I can't wait to get on there. It's like
all right, what else
do
we got?
Me.
What else do we got here?
Well,
this is interesting.
This is interesting. It's not real great as far as a player, but as a collector and a historical value, it's a Liberty, which was a conglomeration of like three or four different turn-of-the-century drum companies that got together with the Liberty Rawhide Manufacturing Company and started their own drum company.
Huh.
And unfortunately for them, they only lasted about a year, and they went out of business, and Slingerland bought all of their tooling and all of their material. So Slingerland started their own company.
Notice this badge, you guys. Take a look at this badge. And if you were standing far away, that to me looks very much like a Slingerland oval badge.
No doubt about it.
Yeah. And there's
no doubt about it.
So you could see the influence there, the Slingerland influence. All right, let's move on. Huh. We saw this last year, didn't we?
This is the 100-year anniversary in
2009. Oh, okay, I'm wrong.
With all the Ludwigs engraved on there. And in the process,
look at that.
I found a head with William F. Jr. on there, and I had Bill B3 sign it along with his daughters. And John Aldridge was here yesterday, and he looked in there and he said, "This was the 83rd one that I did." So I had him sign the head along with it.
What a beautiful piece.
Isn't that a nice piece?
Oh,
that's fabulous.
Man. Larry, that has a lot of significance, you know?
Yeah.
And look, he brought the flatjacks again.
Got the flatjacks again.
This is great. Guys, this is a great story. First of all, look at the shape they're in. Great shape.
It's amazing.
Tell them again, what's
it's
the
amazing.
Story on these flatjacks?
This guy right here.
Right here.
Was Ralph's son-in-law.
Uh-huh.
He actually worked, Ralph, in manufacturing these flatjacks back in the day. So he knows all about it. So this was one of Ralph's personal kits, especially the snare drum. And I'm just thrilled to have him. It's something different. It was a concept that started in the early 60s. He used a lot of Rogers type of hardware.
I see. I thought so. Yeah.
He mixed Rogers along with his own pipe. If you look at these mounts over here, those were like his design. A little different.
Look at that. Look at that price, you guys. Fantastic.
These balls were also his idea. I thought these are like marbles.
Well, those are interesting. Look at these balls for cymbal toppers.
Solid steel marbles.
They're like ball bearings that have been drilled in and beveled. Look at that. That's an incredible idea. Larry Matthews, primo collector. We love to talk to you every year, Larry.
Always
you never
pleasure.
Disappoint.
Always a pleasure.
All right,
thank
man.
So much,
folks,
family.
We'll be back with more Tap of the World's Top Collectors. Mike Corrado, Mark Cooper, Dave Brown, Bunny Carlos. They're all here this year. We'll be back. This is Jim Messina for Vintage Drums Talk.